So, yes. AES is currently probably the most widely used and best known crypto system, I think, all crypto systems today. It's, for example, almost 100% of TLS connections are using AES, and there are a lot of other devices that use it. And its security has been extensively analyzed for more than 20 years, basically since the AES competition. And it has either 10, 12, or 14 round structure, and this depends on the key size. To date, there is no known attack that is against full AES that is significantly faster than exhaustive search. So what we do is we try to analyze a reduced round AES, and we think it is very interesting because this is the best platform that we have to actually analyze what are the remaining security margins that we have. And also there are several lightweight crypto systems that use 4 or 5 round AES as a basic building block. Okay, when we do crypto analysis attacks, we have 3 main parameters that we want to know. What is the time complexity of the attack, how much CPU power do we need, and what is the amount of memory that we need to store in order to run our attack, and how much data, or how many different encryptions do we need to see in order to break the cipher. To combine those 3 complexity measures, it is common to use a single number, we call it the total complexity, which is basically the max of those 3 parameters. Okay, so far in the past 20 years, there were relatively very few techniques that actually led to what we call successful attacks against the FAF around the AES. And all of them hit a specific barrier in a 2 to the 32 complexity measure that we can't do any better than that. Recently, in New York Crypto 2017, Rassit et al. Proposed a new crypto analysis technique. They call it the multiple of 8 attack. And very recently, Grassi had applied a special version of it to what he called the mixture differential attack to 5 round AES. However, again, its complexity was not better than previous attacks, so we are still in the 2 to the 32 barrier. In our work, we were able to break this 20-year-old barrier by a factor of more than 1,000 to get around 2 to the 22 complexity. Okay, so as I'm sure most of you are familiar with, this is the structure of AES. We have 10, 12, or 14 rounds, and in each round we have 4 operations. The first one is the sub-byte operation, shift rows, mixed column, and add-round key. When in the first round we have an extra add-round key operation, and there is no mixed column operation in the last round. And those are the operations. Sub-byte is the only non-linear property of the AES block cipher. It simply takes a single byte. We have a 128-bit state of AES. We can view it as a 4x4 matrix of bytes. And sub-byte simply takes one of the, each of those bytes separately and use a non-linear permutation on it. Afterwards, we have the shift rows operation, which take each row separately and shift it. The first row stays the same. The second row is shifted by 1. This is a cyclic shift. The second row is shifted by 2. And the third one is, the fourth row, excuse me, is shifted by 3. Then we have what's called the mixed column operation. The mixed column operation works on each column separately. And it basically takes all of the different bytes in the column and mix them using a linear transformation. And in the end, we need to also add key material. So each round has its own round key. And what we simply do is we XOR the key value to each byte, to each state byte separately. OK, so I'll try to explain the notation that was introduced by Grassi et al. It's actually a wider application, but this is what we need to in order to understand our attack. So we ask ourselves, what is the mixture of AES state pair? So we have 2 AES states, X and Y, and we want to create a mixture out of them. So we create a mixture ZW. And in this mixture, what we do is basically each byte in Z is either a byte taken from X or taken from Y, and W as the takes the other byte. In our notation, each time we show a blank box, it means that all 4 bytes in this specific position in the matrix are equal. And if there is a specific value written, then all bytes that have this specific value are equal. Okay, and as you can see, we take the first column and we mix it between Z and W, and we can do it with each column separately, and there are 7, for each column, there are 7 possible mixtures. Okay, so now we'll try to start to understand how this specific mixture evolves and the structure of it evolves over time when we input it to the AES. So we assume that we have this mixture at some, it's the input to some round I of AES. And then we do the sub-byte operation. All of the values are changed, but the structure still remains the same. Then we do the shift rows. So the different values are spread to the anti-diagonal. Then we run the mixed column operation. What a mixed column operation is simply takes this one different byte that we have in each column and spreads it over the entire column. However, we still have the same the equality from before, that if we look at any unordered pair of columns for X and Y, it is equal to the unordered pair of the same columns in Z and W. Okay, this is the second one. Then we add round key. Again, the values are changed, but the structure is preserved. And this is, now we get to the input to round I plus 1. So again, we do the subbyte operation. All the values change. Structure remains the same. And now that we can see that although we have equality in the columns, it actually implies a more weaker property, that when we take all of the values in those 4 mixtures, they are sum up to 0. For example, if we have the 2 columns in X and Y are equal to the 2 columns to Z and W, we XOR them, we get 0. And this property is, of course, also correct for each byte separately. So you can see that when we have those blue blocks, then those 4 values sum up to 0. So now this is a linear property. And as shift row, mixed column, and add round key are also linear transformation, this property is preserved to those states. And this brings us to the start of round number 2. So now we have round I plus 2. We have this XOR property. And now we're going to make another assumption. This assumption is that by some chance we encountered this fantastic miracle, and in this miracle, the diagonal of X is equal to the diagonal of Y. As there's a lot of random properties going on, this basically happens with probability of 2 to the minus 32. But now we can see that if the diagonal of X is equal to the diagonal of Y, and the sum of all the 4 values are 0, this also implies that the diagonal of Z is also equal to the diagonal of W. And now we continue the evaluation of the states, and we do the subbyte operation. The subbyte is nonlinear, so it breaks the XOR property, but however, the diagonals are still equal. We do the shift rows. Everything returns to a single column. Then we do the mixed column. Again, the values are changed. The structure remains. And we add the round key. So now we got to round number 3, and we got this specific structure. Then we continue, again, subbyte, shift row, it spreads to the anti-diagonal, and now we're supposed to do the mixed column operation. And this mixed column operation breaks everything because all of the different values will be spread. However, as we said before, in the last round of AES, there is no mixed column operation. So if you're looking at only 4 round AES, this is the structure that we get after 4 rounds. So what we basically get here is a distinguisher. Because if we start from a mixture structure, we'll get with probability 2 to the minus 32, we'll get this structure in the end. If AES was a real random permutation, we've gotten this structure with probability 2 to minus 64. So this allows us to distinguish between AES and random permutation, but we're more interested in recovering keys. So the basic idea that Gassi has shown is that we precede those 4 rounds with an extra round before them. What we do is we take this input structure and where all of the values remains the same except for the values on the diagonal, and then we encrypt all possible values of A, B, C, and D. What we get is an input to round one is this structure, and this is actually all of the values in the first column here are a simple permutation of the of the diagonal of the state and input to and the input to AES, and they only depend on four specific key bytes. And this actually gives us all of the possible mixtures that we can have on the first column. So we'll try to follow the original Grassi attack. We basically what we do, we look for a single good ciphertext pair where we have equality on the anti-diagonal. And then what we do is we retrieve the plain text because we encrypted all of the possible values. We have the plain text of x and y. And then what we do is simply iterate over all possible 2 to the 32 key bytes. And we do a partial encryption of the of x and y. And we get the and we get this structure. Now what we do is we choose one possible matrix out of the mixture out of the possible 7 and create the mixture of the mixture pair Z and W. Then we go back, we use the same key that we used before to partly decrypt Z and W and get a plaintext suggestion. As we have all of the possible encryption of the structure, we can find what is the ciphertext that, are, that we get from Z and W. And what we do now is simply check this equality condition. If the anti-diagonal is equal in this case, then we guess the right key and we'll finish. Otherwise, we discard this key and keep on iterating. So this is a new type of attack. However, we still have the same previous complexity that we had before of 2 to the 32, and we want to improve it. So we had several ideas on how to improve the original attack. In our tech, and the first idea is that we can reduce the amount of data that we need. However, we pay with extra time complexity, so this is not really good. Then what we do is we switch the order of operation inside the tech algorithm. This helps us reduce the time complexity even further to 2 to the 33, but we're still worse than the previous attacks. And then what we see is that we can use some small pre-computed tables to further improve our attack, get 2 to 29. This is already the best currently known attack. But then what we can add it a smarter selection of the input structure that allows us to get to the full, 2 to the 22 and improve it by a factor of 1,000. So I'll try to expand those ideas. So the first idea that we have is that in Grassi attack, we get all of the possible good metrics that we have on this specific one column structure. But we only need one good mixture in order to retrieve the key. And we can do the calculation and we see that with 2 to the 33 data, we get a lot of possibly good pairs. And if we use only 2 to the 24 data, we can still get a good enough 2 to 15 good pairs, which have equality on the anti-diagonal, and these give us at least one good mixture with very high probability. So we can reduce the data complexity. However, it means that we have 2 to the 15 different good pairs that we need to iterate over them in order to find the one good pair that gives us the good mixture. And this takes time, so we have now 2 to the 47 because we have the original 2 to the 32 complexity times 2 to the 15. And basically what we get is just a time data trade-off, not really improvement, and this is actually not a very good time data trade-off because we increase the time by a factor of 2 to the 15 and only improve the data complexity by 2 to the 8. The second idea that we had is that we can change the order of operation. And because the basic observation is that if we have a mixture after the first round, then again, the sum of all values is zero. And this again is true to each byte separately. And for each byte, there is only one key byte that will give us this zero sum after we do the SBox operation. So we can find a suggestion for each of the four key bytes separately. This is, of course, much more efficient than trying the whole 2 to the 32 together. And then after we have the four key byte suggestions, we take them all and we actually do the partial encryption and we check if we get a mixture or not. Okay, and again, this is not good enough, because for each key byte we need to have 2 to the 8 S-box application in order to check to get the right key byte, and this still gives us too much time complexity. Okay, so the third idea is that instead of doing this 2 to the 8 operation, we can use a pre-computed table. The details are not really important, but basically we can use we can optimize it to a really really small table of 2 to the 21 table of 4-byte values, and a pre-computation takes about 2 to the 24 S-box application. This is all negligible compared to the entire attack. And by using this pre-computation, we can remove this 2 to the 8 factor. Okay, so now we got 2 to the 24 data and 2 to the 29 time complexity, but again, we want to do a little bit better. And what we see is that now we only need part of the input structure. We don't need to go over the entire diagonal. And instead of just picking random values out of the possible 32, we use a specific structure, and we actually keep at least 1 byte constant. And this actually boosts the probability of getting a good mixture by a factor of 2 to the 8. And this allows us to use less data, accurately 2 to the 22.25 data. Okay, due to the very, very low complexity of the attack, we were able to experimentally verify our attack and actually run quite a lot of simulation, and to get the real distribution of probabilities of key recovery. And we did it to different amounts of data and quite a lot of keys, and we got the whole key recovery probability matrix. We also tried to extend our attack, and we were able to extend this to up to 7-round AES. And in a 7-round AES, so it's not the right slide, but okay, 7-round AES, we actually get an improvement in a specific regime that we call the particle data and memory regime, in which we assume that it's much harder to get a lot of data and a lot of memory than extra time complexity. So we want the data and memory complexity to be something that we find reasonable even today. However, the time complexity is still not very fast, but the best that we can have. Okay, so to summarize, we were able to break a 20-year-old attack complexity barrier on 5-round AES, and we improved it by a factor of more than 1,000. We also obtained and improved what we call particle data and memory attack on 7-round AES. And what we ask ourselves now is it possible to extend this new attack technique to larger versions of AES, which we were not able to do before? And can we take the result of this attack and this distribution properties and try to use them to attack this new lightweight crypto schemes that use this reduced round AES as a component? And that is it. We'll be happy to take questions. Thank you.